out someone stop this train. Hey everyone, welcome back to the Pluck and Chuck Guitar Series, and we are going on with Stop This Train by John Mayer. And we are definitely getting into a whole nother phase of the guitar series entirely. You know, so we have a different background, kind of goes with all the changes we're going through. We're coming back to quarter note grooves, but now these songs are starting to get more advanced. I would definitely put these in the sort of intermediate advanced area of guitar technique. We are starting to do single chucks in our songs, where we have to pick out individual notes just by doing our chucks. So while you're doing the thumb slap, you're also picking a note. See, the thumb slap and the fingers flicking at the same time. And the fact that you have to pick out melodies inside your patterns doing this means it's very game-changing in terms of the feel of the guitar texture and the techniques that you can do. Now you can start to pick out melodies with more accuracy than you could before. So it's definitely going to test your technique to another level, but it's going to open all kinds of doors. And the other thing you're going to notice, we're starting to see a lot of John Mayer at this part of the series, because John Mayer is kind of the quintessential Pluck and Chuck guitarist up to this point in history. He definitely has the most songs in the style. He has the most advanced techniques with it. And so this is the first of many John Mayer songs we're going to be doing in the very near future. Also, this lesson is going to be a little bit different in its delivery than the other ones. I'm still going to start out by doing a section where I explain the fretting hand and a section where I do the picking hand. But I'm not going to spend as much time on each of those things because really this song is, it doesn't have like a straight groove that is the same the whole way through. A lot of other songs had like one pattern that would go over all the chords and you could just make really minor variations to it. This song is not like that. The different sections of the song are very independent from each other. They're very different patterns in each one. And so it's easier just to kind of explain them all individually. So you can use the lesson navigator below to get to the different parts of the lesson, but really think about how you're going to learn this best. You really got to think about your individual style of learning. First, I'm going to just go over the chords that he uses, but they're more of just the shapes that he's using. I'm not going to go over everything that happens on every chord. And then I'm going to explain some things about the picking patterns and the techniques we're using in this song, but I'm not going to go through every single pattern and exactly how it goes over every chord. I'm just going to give you a general idea to get your hands going. And then in the integration section, which normally is the part where I put all those things together, I'm really going to explain every single phrase. And I'm going to do it a little differently than some other lessons. I'm going to explain how the different melodies are working together. And we're going to kind of layer one melody at a time into each of these patterns. So you're going to sort of hear how it's constructed. Because this song has a very vocal quality to it. There's a lot of vocal lines. There's a lot of just melodic lines that are built into the phrases in this song. And if you can't hear them, and if you can't, you know, bring them out sort of by hearing them and, you know, having your hand adjust the intensity it's playing different lines at, then the power of the song is really lost. The subtlety and the texture is really kind of, it's not there if you can't hear those things. So I'm going to build this a little differently than probably a lot of other teachers do. I'm not just going to give you an endless string of notes and which fingers to play where. I'm going to, like, build it in terms of how the phrases are actually constructed. So it should be an exciting lesson. I'd say let's get down to it. So this song is broken up into some different parts. It's like every other song. It's got sections that you can follow pretty easily. And a lot of times you'll have a single chord, or more likely you'll have a single bass note that he's playing around a lot. So a lot of times I won't say what chord it is. I'll just say it's G stuff, you know, because that's an easier way to describe it than to talk about all the extensions. So like the song starts out with this riff. Say it's D9, D13 stuff. It's really just D, because the open D string is always in it, and then you're kind of fretting different notes on the D, the G, and the B string. The G, the B, and the E string. Yeah. So first thing you're going to do, you're going to want to use the middle finger on the second fret of the A string, and the ring finger on the third fret of the B string. Just kind of brush those all open. Your thin E string is open. Then you're going to take your middle finger, slide it up to the sixth fret, and move that ring finger over to the thin E string. So now it's on, is that the 7th fret of the thin E string? So you have 6th fret of the D string, 7th fret of the E string. You're then going to let the ring finger go, and you're going to have the pointer finger on the 5th fret of the E string. It's your 3rd chord. And then you're going to bring this back down to the open position. middle finger is back on two on the D string, and then you're just brushing its top four strings again. So you have the B and the E open, the D's open, middle finger's on second fret of the G string. So that whole sequence, if you just brush the chords. And then you put the picking pattern that you have over that, which we'll do later. And next you're gonna do basically the same thing with a G in the bass. And let me just say right now, generally speaking, you can definitely get to these bass notes with your thumb or with your pointer finger. I will switch between the two because there's a couple stretches that John does, like this one, we're gonna get to in a second. That's one of the only stretches of guitar I've never been able to get. It's just too big for my hand with the guitars that I play. So you'll see me kind of switching between using a thumb voicing and a finger voicing for certain things. You can do whatever's more comfortable for your hand. Both will work. So the first thing you're doing, you've got the third fret of the thick E string down here. Then you got the pointer finger, second fret of the thin E string, and middle finger, third fret of the B string. And you can pretty much hit any of the notes except the A string. You don't want to hit the open A string. All the other notes are game. It's a G major 7 thing. And that's the first chord of the second part. Then he's going to go back up to the same shape he was up on with the D chord. I'm using the ring finger, 6th fret of the G string, and now it's the pinky on the 7th fret of the E string. Notice it's the same as with the D shape. But now you've got to get this note down here. So I'm using my pointer finger, kind of stretching out. You know, John uses those same two fingers, but does it with his thumb. I just can't do it cleanly, so I do it like this. The pinky's going to come off and get you to the same chord that you were with the D shape, except now you have middle finger on the 5th fret, ring finger on the 6th fret. And then when you come back down here, the pointer finger's on the 2nd fret of the D string again. So you'll see with this G bass note, it's a lot of similar shapes. It's really just this first kind of two notes that are different, but then it's the same shapes you had with the D chord, and whichever finger you want to use to get this bass note is fine. Eventually you could probably find your way around it with a couple different fingerings, so make sure you work those two out. And then with the G bass note. And that is pretty much how the verses and the intro go. So that's a lot of the song right there. The next thing we're going to get into is the chorus. And the chorus, we're going to have to explain most of it in the integration section because there's a lot of melodic material that goes with. But I'll show you the chords real quick. First chord is a G minor major 7 chord. I'm using my thumb down here to get the 3rd fret of the thick E string. And then you have 3rd fret of the G and the B string. And then 2nd fret of the E string. And you can have the open D string also. It's very similar to the G major 7 we had before, but you're adding this B flat right here that makes the chord kind of creepy. You can also do it, you know, different ways with other fingers. Maybe you could, well, actually getting it with the thumb's probably the easiest way to do this one. I suppose you could figure it this way with the middle finger down here, but I would generally recommend using the thumb for this. That makes this much easier. All right, so you have the G minor major 7. Then it's going to go to D add 9 with an F sharp in the bass. If you guys have been following the series, you're probably sick to death of this chord because it's in all of these songs. So again, you have 2nd fret of the thick E string down here, 2nd fret of the G string, 3rd fret of the B string, and thin E string is open. So you see, it's not too far from our G minor major 7. I just kind of bring my pointer finger over there from the E string and you're there. I'll show you that transition again. After that, you're going to drop anything on the thick E string, that open thick E string, and this is a form of an E7 voicing. Now, I'm going to recommend you use these fingers. You can either use the ring finger or the pinky on the 3rd fret of the B string, and then the pointer finger on the 1st fret of the G string, because you need a finger here on the thin E string to play melodies, so I'd either put one of these two fingers there so your middle finger can go... The last thing you're going to do for the chorus is you're going to come up here. It's almost like a dust in the wind figure right here. You got the pointer finger on the 5th fret of the D string and the ring finger on the 7th fret of the G string. Then the notes on the G string are going to walk down chromatically. You're going to bring it down to the 6th fret with the middle finger. Then I'm going to do a shift so you can get the 5th fret and then the 4th fret of the G string. There's a couple different ways to finger this. I'm just going to, you know, just show you that particular way. But almost, you know, you could also use the middle and the ring finger there. It's not terribly critical. The key is that that line is happening, and you're kind of brushing everything from the A string up to the E string is game in this. It's another way to get through it. Just kind of sliding back here and then just switching these fingers. That's pretty smooth. It's a good way to finger it. So let me go over that whole chorus progression one more time just to throw you through it. G minor major 7. D F sharp add 9. E7. Let me put that in there, becomes a 9th. And then it becomes sort of an A walk down progression. And that will get you through the chorus of the song. There's a couple other things that happen in sort of around the third verse in the bridge. Let's see if I can explain those real quick. First of all, there's a section where he sort of chromatically alters chords. It's almost a variation on the chorus. But you have this G major 7 chord here again. I think he's using the ring finger on the... I guess that would be the... Yeah, I guess that's on the 4th fret of the G string. So he's kind of adding that to this. So instead of having an open G string, you have 4th fret of the G string. After that, he's going to switch it to a G minor 7 chord. And what I'm doing, I'm just keeping the thumb down here. Or you suppose you could do it with the finger too, but for now I'm keeping the thumb down here. And I'm doing middle finger 3rd fret of the G string, ring finger 3rd fret of the B string, pointer finger 1st fret of the E string. It's almost like a little B flat chord up here over a G. You could finger it also like this with the middle finger down there, ring finger, pinky, pointer finger. That works too. Next is the D with the F sharp in the bass and the E9 chord we had before. So those are straight out of the same chorus progression we had before. And then you're going to go right back into the chorus progression exactly as it was. So that's sort of a lead-in to the second to last chorus, if you can find that later on. But you'll notice when it comes up, when he's saying, had a talk with my old man, said help me understand, he said turn 68, you'll renegotiate, don't stop this train. That's when that part happens. And one other little snag that goes on that you'll definitely want to be aware of for the left hand is he's going to do this long walk up. It's almost like the blackbird position, you know, where he's kind of coming down. Yeah, it's kind of using one of those sorts of things. So specifically, I'm using my ring finger on the 3rd fret of the E string and playing the D, the G, and the B strings open. Then I'm putting my middle finger here on the 2nd fret of the B string and playing the A, the D, and the G strings open. Then pointer finger 2nd fret of the A string, ring middle finger 3rd fret of the B string, and then I'll slide that up, and this is on the 4th fret, this is on the 5th fret, open D and G strings. So you see there's a lot of open strings going on sort of around these shell voicings of chords. Some different ways to finger it. I'm going to say that's the way I'm going to recommend right there. And he's basically just switching between an A chord. This is an a G, this is a G chord. That's an A chord. This is a G with a B in the bass. This is an A with some extra notes and a C sharp in the bass. He's really just switching between A and G here. And he's kind of climbing up the neck, so it kind of has a sense of rising even though it's just two chords. Kind of a cool effect. And then after he does that a couple of times, he's going to resolve it to this little thing. I'll explain that in detail in a bit, but the main thing is it's sort of a shell voicing of a D7 chord. You got pointer finger 5th fret of the A string, ring finger 7th fret of the D string, and pinky on the 7th fret of the B string. And your G string is open. You pick through that. And it's an A minor 9 chord. You could kind of play it sort of like this, but really this note isn't in there, so really the only thing you need is the pointer finger on the 5th fret of the G string. And your B string is open, so you have the open A string, 5th fret of the G string, and open B string. And then there's sort of an open E minor 7 chord, so you're playing the thick E string open, D string open, G string open. B string has the 3rd fret. I'm just playing it with the pointer finger because I find it easy to get to. But to show you that ending one more time, it's when you're driving away in the dark. That's when that whole thing happens. And it's right after, you know, you come out of... And you don't miss a thing to cry when you're driving away in the dark. And that is pretty much all of the left-hand material. We'll explain the melodic stuff later on in the lesson, but if you can get through those chords, you're on a good track to get the rest of the song down. So now we are into the fun stuff. We are into the picking techniques for this song. And as I said, we are now getting into songs where we have to do single chucks. And I will be the first one to tell you, I had quite a bit of difficulty with these techniques when I was just getting used to it. I still struggle with this to some degree. So this would actually be a really good time, if you haven't seen it yet, to go check out the series intro video. It'll say intro to the Pluck and Chuck guitar series, because I have some exercises in that that will take you through. Just some exercises that will get your hand moving around the different strings with single chucks. And you want to make sure you're at least somewhat comfortable with this technique before you get too into the song, because it can get a little frustrating if you're not comfortable with it. But either way, the first thing to do is kind of get used to the idea of when you're doing your thumb slap, to just be able to hit just one string and just kind of lean through one string and wind up on the next one. Get a nice clear. Different strings that'll give you some flexibility, but really the main strings you're going to be doing it on are the D and the G string this time. So get used to that idea first, and the next thing we're going to start to do is integrate it into some patterns. And you see, the trick is that you're doing this thumb slap constantly. This is just a straight quarter note groove. It's a very irregular throughout the whole song. This almost never stops in this song. It's a very constant quarter note groove. So in that sense, the thumbs work is very, very easy. The trick is that the fingers have to go with that, and whenever the thumb is doing the slap, you know, the fingers have to be doing whatever they're naturally doing and not break their stride. So if you're playing an arpeggio and the thumb's doing a thumb slap, whatever finger is going at the same time as the thumb slap has to be able to go in the opposite direction that the other fingers were going when they were plucking. So you've got to be able, that middle finger's got to be able to do, got to be able to do a chuck instead of a pluck. Now, actually, I should clarify that. I got a hunch John only chucks with his pointer finger. So that particular arpeggio, you could go, see, I struggle with that a little bit because I don't practice that way. And this is a demonstration of an important thing. John is the type of person, he'll do all his chucks. He'll just move the pointer finger around wherever it needs to go. He'll go pluck the D string, chuck the G string, and then pick with the middle finger. And that'll work fine. What I prefer to do is to use the pointer finger. You just assign each of these strings to each of these fingers to a string. see, I come a lot cleaner playing that way because, you know, I don't have to move my fingers around. I don't get lost at all. And that's the way I prefer to play. But my trick with that is that I have to train all my fingers to be able to chuck. My pointer finger's got to be as good as my middle finger, as good as my ring finger, and if you're really wacky like me, it's got to be as good as your pinky. So now might be a good time to choose which way you want to do it. Either way will work. This song doesn't have a ton of string shifting in. Like I said, most of the chucks are either on the D or the G string. So really, it doesn't matter which way you do it, but you really should just pick and stick with it, because as you can see, it's not easy to be equally good at the Piedmont style chucking, where it's just the pointer finger and the kind of all finger chucking. So whatever you do, just, you know, just pick randomly. It almost doesn't even matter which one you do. Ultimately, using more fingers, it will let you have more technique. There's more things you can do with it, but it's a little harder to train in the beginning. So it's a thing to think about as you're going into this song. Okay, enough talk about technique. Let's get actually into the techniques of this song. So the first thing you want to make sure you can do is just a straight quarter note groove with the thumb. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm assuming people have done some of this before, so I'm not going to go into it with great detail, but spend a little bit of time just counting fours and making sure that your thumb slaps are on 2 and 4. It's a good thing to get used to. The next thing you're going to have to do is get some of the really common patterns in this song. And one of the first patterns that shows up, he's got some plucks coming right after the chucks, and that takes a little getting used to. So the first pattern I want you to try to do is this. You're going to have the thumb and the pointer finger together, and then you're going to do a single chuck with the pointer finger chucking the open D string. So you have that so far. And then right after the pointer finger does its chuck, the ring finger is going to pluck. Let me slow that down a little bit. 3, 4, and... Because it takes some getting used to having these, what I call anti-chucks, come right after the chucks. I call them that because even though these are regular finger plucks, the finger's got to be ready as soon as you come out of that kind of into the guitar stroke. So it takes a little bit of getting used to how to aim this finger so that it's right there, ready to go after that. So take some time with just this pattern. And see if you can get it up to this speed. When you think you've got that going on, the next thing you're going to have to do is practice doing anti-chucks with the same finger you did your chuck with. Because this actually happens a couple times in this early pattern in the John Mayer song. So you're doing the chuck with the pointer finger, but then it's coming right back up and plucking again. So if I slow that down, 3 and 4. Then try to speed that up a little bit when you're ready. So you can get a clean sound out of it as much as you can. And the next thing we're going to do, once you've got that down, is some of these sort of rolling arpeggios. John throws a lot of arpeggios into this, just sort of triadic arpeggios. You know, just three strings right next to each other. And sometimes they're going up. Going pointer finger towards the ring, and sometimes they're going down, ring finger towards the pointer finger. So we're going to try both of these. If I finger just any sort of G chord, it almost doesn't matter what kind, this is the pattern we're going to do. The thumb's going to go first, the pointer finger second, the middle finger after that, and the ring finger after that. Just try this finger picking first. And then switch into the pluck and chuck mode once you've got that. So whenever the middle finger would have gone, you're also going to have a thumb slap with it. And whether you're using your pointer finger or your middle finger to do the chuck, sort of substitute that in there. So if I'm using my pointer finger to do the chuck, I'm going thumb, pointer, pointer, antichuck ring, I guess middle. And then if you're doing all finger chucks, you just keep the middle finger in there, and that's the one that does the chuck. That single chuck to make sure that the arpeggio remains uninterrupted. If you're really playing it well, it's going to sound, you make your chuck sound exactly like your plucks, and then it really just kind of blends into the texture. So sort of try to have that in mind as you're practicing this. It's not an easy thing to do because the stroke's going in a different direction, you're using a different part of your finger. Blending it is not always easy, but you know, have that in your mind to do it as much as you can. And then once you've got that down, going on that sort of ascending arpeggio, try to do it descending. Do the thumb and then ring middle pointer. So finger picking is just... with pluck a chuck. Either of those will do, but you want to get used to doing those patterns first before you get into the song, because that'll really get your hand in a place where it needs to be. So hopefully you've got some idea of how your picking and your fretting are going to go up to this point, and now we're going to start to put it together. A really important aspect of this song is getting to hear the different vocal lines in it. There's a lot of parts in it that sound very much like singing, and you really want to hear those. Taking this musical approach to the song is really, really important to getting like just the best qualities of it. So I'm going to be approaching this more and explaining it in terms of the layers that are going on rather than just giving you note for note sorts of things. I'll give you a little bit of both, but let me show you how the first kind of opening riff goes. What we're looking at is... it's pretty much that right there. And the first thing you have, you really want to hear, is this thumb groove going on. It's just as simple as 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Thumbs on the open D string. It's going to be that way for a little while. So see if you can get that in place first. The next thing you want to hear is... and it's the same rhythm through each one of the chords. So... you, first of all, you're picking middle finger on the B string and ring finger on the E string. And then the ring finger is going to be on the open E string for everything except the first chord. The first pluck is right with the first thumb stroke, so just get that down. And then the ring finger stroke is always going to be right after the thumb slap. Got to add the pointer finger, which is doing all these sort of in-between accompaniment parts going on. So already you can hear three voices going on. So if I take it just one stroke at a time, see if you can just, the double pluck at the beginning, the chuck where you're chucking the A right there, and then on that fourth stroke you're plucking the open E string. So work that in. And then as you hear this line go up, this sort of middle voice is going to slide us up to this next part of the position. So after, you get, you're going to have a thumb stroke, a pluck, and a chuck that's going to slide us up. Thumb, pluck, chuck. Thumb, pluck, chuck. Thumb, pluck, chuck. So take a second, get that fragment, and put it together with... first sort of open position D shape has one right hand picking pattern. All the other chords after it are going to have a picking pattern of their own, which is a little bit different from this first chord, so see if you can catch the similarity. It'll make it a little easier. So once you're up here, you're starting with the thumb and the ring finger together, and then you're chucking and plucking the ring finger again. So those first three strokes. See if you can get that. And again, you're chucking on the, so this is the sixth fret of the G string. So get that part. The second little part is that. You're plucking with the thumb, then you're plucking with the pointer finger, again on the G string, and then you're chucking something on the open B string. It's either your middle or your ring finger. So get those three strokes down and see if you can put it with the first four strokes that you had. And that would give you this. Once you've got that down, you can rejoice because you can use that exact same picking pattern from the other chords, sort of transfer it onto the next sorts of things. Take that ring finger away. And then down to the open position. Whole D riff together, the main thing you want to be able to hear is the melody that's coming out of your two thinner strings. So see if I can play this and really get the color to come out. At the very least, you want to be aware of the subtlety of the movements between the voices. That's really what's going to give this the nice, just kind of delicate quality that it has. So once you've got that first riff down, you're ready to go on to the G riff, which is almost the same. Again, this first chord that you've got, the picking's a little different, but then the picking is exactly the same for the next three chords. So let's go over this first one. So you've got, you're in your G major 7 shape, you're plucking the thumb and the middle finger together, you're chucking with the pointer finger, and then antichucking or plucking with the ring finger. So get that down onto your fingers. And then you don't have to worry about the slide this time, but you still have a very similar. You have a pluck and then a chuck again. Thumb pluck chuck. Put those strokes all together with the first strokes you did. You get. Then once you've got those strokes put together, you're up here to continue the riff, and you're playing the exact same picking pattern you were playing when you're up here with the D chord, with the exception of your thumb is now down here on the thick E string. So you should find, if you can get your left hand around, I guess your fretting hand around all this, you shouldn't have too much difficulty. You should be able to just go. Sometimes a little hard to think when your hand is stretched out like this. That's definitely a thing to get used to. And if you spend a lot of time just going from here to here and getting used to getting around that particular switch up to there, the rest of it should be much easier. So see if you can transfer as much of the picking pattern from the last riff we did into this one. So now we are getting into the chorus of this song. And this is probably the trickiest part of the song because there's the most intermittent finger picking in between the most complex melodies. So the first thing I'm going to show you is just how to play the melody over the thumb groove, because really you could make up your own sort of patterns to go in here, whatever you find to be the most convenient. And if you really want to do exactly what John Mayer does, there's a good score out for this. If you just, you know, get the the studio edition of the score for this record, it pretty much shows exactly what John plays. I mean, I think it's very insightful to learn that. I usually don't play exactly that because I find the fills that he does very hard to remember. So I've kind of created a simplified version here that I use for myself and that I teach people. But really, the most important thing is that you have... important thing, and then you can fill it in with arpeggios, with just, you know, extra chucks. Let me just give you an idea of how you might fill it in. I don't even remember exactly what I did there, and I'd probably do it different if I played it again next time, but it's the fillers, how you kind of fill out the chord is not the most important thing. The fact that you do it somehow so that the harmony is full is important. So first thing I'm going to do is, you know, we got our thumb groove, it's going. I'm going to pick the thumb and the pinky together. After that second thrum stroke, right after you're picking again, and we're on the second fret of the thin E string, and those pinky strokes, they come right after each of the thumb strokes. We got a pluck stroke, slap stroke, pluck stroke, slap stroke. Just that much down. Once you have that going into the next, I wanna get off and go home. And again, you're starting thumb and the finger together. And now you've got three strokes that kind of come right off of your thumb strokes, except now you've got third fret, second fret, open string on the E string. So what I'd recommend is, you know, you get these strokes, fingers together. You really want to just practice feeling like you're bouncing off your thumb. It's like every time you hit that thumb stroke. So we're going together. Ah, ah, ah. You can almost feel like you want to feel like every time this does something, this comes right after it. I'd almost practice this with the strings muted just to get used to having this finger always be doing something right after this does a thumb slap and the pick stroke. And getting used to that will kind of help you get the offbeat feel of that line. So after you're done. Those are two more offbeat strokes that are coming. So right after that one thumb slap, you're going one, two, and three, and four, and one, and two, and three, and four. You're playing third fret B string, open E string. Got that much down, we're ready to go into the next riff, where we're over the D-add 9 chord. And we're starting again, fingers together. Third fret, and then you're going back to the thin E string. Second fret, open string. Together. Right after this, thumb stroke. And after that, thumb slap. play that with me. We've gotten that first part of the D-add 9 chord melody. We're doing, I can't take the speed it's moving at. And it's like every other line, first stroke of the bar together, I'm doing a hammer-on to the second fret of the thin E string for I can't. And we're going to be in, right into an offbeat lick again, right after this first thumb. I can't take the speed. It's very similar to what we just had for. Walking down here from 3rd fret, 2nd fret, open string, except before the thumb was here, now it's down here on the 2nd fret. So, I can't take the speed. So here we have another hammer-on that's right on the beat. So right on that 4th beat where you're doing the thumb, you're doing the finger pluck at the same time and doing a hammer-on. So, can't take the speed. Again, we're in unison. Take the speeds. Then we're ready to get into the E7 chord. I can't take the speed, it's moving in. So you want to have 3rd fret of the B string, kind of a hammer on to the thin E string there. Together, off beat. Section where you say, I know I can't. There's a pickup there. Usually you don't play, I know I can't. Or at least John usually doesn't. I find it inconvenient to do so. So usually I'll go just, I know I can't. So it's almost like you're just playing, no, I can't. So you're still on open, thick E string. I know I can't. So again, offbeats. Over the E chord. Then once you've gotten all the melody up to that point, you're going to go into this ascending riff. But before we get into that, I just want to sum up the whole melody up to that point. See if we can just play it really slowly with me. So get this going. Worked out the melody. This last section, it's kind of set in its way. So we might as well just explain it the way it is. First thing you have is, again, you're in this sort of dust in the wind position. Pointer finger, 5th fret of the D string. Ring finger, 7th fret of the G string. You're going to pluck the open A and the G string together. So we're playing the thumb and the middle finger together. And then we're chucking and having the ring finger follow on the open B string. See if you can get that down. And then you're going to have two kind of offbeat plucks coming in with the middle finger as you move down. Then again, just like everything we were doing in the previous section, they're all kind of right after thumb strokes. Thumb, pluck, pluck, pluck. So there's a thumb pluck and then a finger pluck and then a thumb slap and another finger pluck. Off, off. So Now, what you'll be comforted to know is that it's pretty much the exact same right hand pattern or picking hand pattern the whole way through that. You're just really walking down the line. There's a little fill-in where you'll go. After you do that second offbeat pluck, thumb, pointer finger, chuck, and then pluck the open B string. So see if you can fill that in. Thumb, pointer, pointer, chuck, ring. Fill that in after the... And then if you can spin that pattern out a little bit further, you're getting it's kind of offbeat middle fingers, but it's just with the moving bass line going down. So now it's... If I continue this pattern the whole way through, I'm just going to take a leap of faith and see if I can just keep this going. Middle, middle. And then right at the end, you just repeat this pattern. That sort of filler pattern I gave you. You just do that twice in a row. And then you're back into it. So one more time, let's try to play that whole pattern really, really slowly. So if I want to clarify that just a little bit more, there's the offbeat middle finger plucks going on this string, and then there's the sort of filler pattern, where you're sort of plucking the fingers around that string. You're plucking the D and the B string. So if I follow it through, you know, you started at the middle fingers, the filler, middle fingers, the filler, middle fingers, the filler again. And that's kind of how the whole thing is built. So there's some different ways to kind of expand on the melody and the chorus here. It's really not expanding the melody, it's just these little fills that happen. Sometimes it's just, you know, chuck strums. You're just chucking a couple strings. Sometimes it's those arpeggio motions I told you about. Sometimes they're going down. Sometimes they're going up. Same motions that I showed you in the picking hand section earlier. So you can think about interspersing those in there almost any way you feel like, but I'm going to show you a very specific way to get through it right now if you just need an answer. So we're just going to take it a riff at a time and put the whole chorus together. I'm just going to show you. You do outer fingers, and then I'm sort of chucking the D string and plucking the G string. You really need to make sure you catch this B flat here, because that's what colors the chord. First four strokes, two together, and then two separate. Once you've got that down, you've got two strokes that are kind of right between the thumb strokes. You got a thumb pluck, pluck the thick E, thumb slap, pluck the thin E again. Put those together. And then usually I'll fill in with one of the arpeggios after that. Start by going downward, but I'll kind of start it with the middle string. I'll show you more time real slowly. Arpeggio going down. To take that out of context, kind of looks like that. So see if you can work that into. Here's your first bar of it. And now, second bar of this, we're going, I wanna get off and go. And usually what I'll do is I'll just throw in really short downward arpeggios, really just of two notes on the G and the D string. You're going, I wanna get off. Just throwing those two notes in there. I wanna get off. Wanna get off. And then these two notes are kind of off the beat, so you're kind of continuing the pattern. And go. So you want to kind of continue that offbeat finger pattern. I wanna get off and go. And those are just, those two notes are good enough to end the bar. You don't need other fills. There's enough melody going on that you can just go, I wanna get off, fill, and go. One more time, I'll play that. I wanna get off. Now you're ready to do home again, and you've got home again. And again, just like the last bar, I'll kind of throw in just a two note, just, I guess it'd be A, it's A on the G string and then open D. Home. In between the thumb pattern. Throw those two. I do the chuck on the G string and then just pluck the open D string right after it. Home, chuck, pluck. Again. Home, again. And then we're on to the next bar. I can't take the speed. This bar is actually easier to fill in. I usually just fill it in with chuck strums. I can't take the speed. Literally on every beat where there's a chuck, you just throw one of those in there. It makes it really easy. I can't take the speed. It'd always be easy if you could do the whole melody over that. It'd get a little monotonous, but you probably could get away with a lot of that. So now we're looking at moving at. And then we gotta be in the E7 chord shape. And see what I'm doing? I just took the D and the G string and just used them as the fill. The D up here on the third fret of the B string is our melody note. So we did move, pointer, middle. Just use those two notes as a fill. Similar thing to the last bar. And then we're throwing in sort of that downward arpeggio series we had really, really early in this. So I know the pointer finger chucks, middle finger plucks, melody notes, and then middle pointer, and then to kind of go that double downward arpeggio series. No, I can't. Downward arpeggios. Again. And no, I can't. And no, I can't. And at that point, you're right back into this. the riff you had before, and there's no more melodic stuff to really fill in. It's just a walk down. So if I play the whole chorus really, really slowly using those fill-ins, it looks sort of like this. I won't sing along. See if you can sing the melody along as I'm playing the notes. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the one other section that's going on in this that you got to be attentive to is this thing about rolling arpeggios. Whenever he's going, had a talk with my old man, said help me understand, said turn 68, we renegotiate. As you're getting through that, the picking pattern is not too hard. It's really just a matter of just getting used to doing it over the chords. So again, got the G major 7, the G minor 7, the D F sharp add 9, the E 7, and then we're back into the chorus. And really all you're doing is you're going, the thumb starts and the pointer finger middle ring, except you got to put on every second finger stroke. Got a chuck going on. So I'm doing the middle finger here, so I'm doing thumb pointer chuck with the middle ring. Thumb pointer chuck ring. Thumb pointer. So it's only four stroke pattern. It's pretty easy to remember. And then you just do it over each of the chords. You can just kind of hold it if you want to, just get used to it. Chord as long as you feel like. But when you actually do it in the song, you just do it four times each. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then the one other place where that figure occurs is when he's doing that rising bit. For once in a while, when it should. And I feel like it should, and they're all. And that's the exact same pattern going on. Except now you've got to watch. The thumb is going to start out on the E string because it's got to finger this G note down here. And then as you get up to this, it's on the A string. And then it's going to stay on the same couple of strings. But, you know, before you had the fingers on the G, the B, and the E string. Now you've got them on the D, the G, and the B string. The thumb's got to move just for that, you know, just after that first chord where it's on the E string. So it looks kind of like this. Just do that again and again. Still around, and you're still safe and sound, and you don't miss a thing. Third time. To cry when you're driving away in the dark. So that last little riff, and you're on this kind of open D chord. Pointer finger, fifth fret, A string, ring finger, seventh fret, D string, pinky, seventh fret, B string. You start by doing the thumb and the ring finger together on the outer strings, and then D and the B. And then you do the middle and the pointer on the G and the D respectively. So it looks like. Then you go to the A minor chord. Just the pointer finger here on the fifth fret of the G string. The thumb and the middle finger are together. or the thumb and the pointer finger, it doesn't matter. But whatever finger is next to the finger you pluck this with is going to pluck the open B string. So in this case, now I'm using the pointer in the middle, and I'm going... pointer with the thumb, middle pointer. And then you're just going to brush... C minor 7 chords. Open E string, open D string, open G string, 3rd fret of the B string. So the whole riff would be... all there is to stop this train. You're ready to put the whole song together.
I know.